Good morning, everyone. It's Sunday, July 11th, and I am freezing. I'm in our cabin in Wisconsin where there's no air conditioning or heat, and yes, it's 58 degrees this morning, as you can see by the fire. Now, some of you who are living in other parts of the country might think this is outrageous. However, let me tell you what's outrageous. Tomorrow, it's going to jump 30 degrees, and it's going to be in the 90s. Like there's no global warming. Well, that's what we're going to talk about today, actually. We're going to talk about climate change, and specifically, how we treat the Earth. Do we play well with the Earth? But before we get into our message, let me just share with you a couple of fun things coming up at Madison. Today, for example, is our virtual coffee hour. At 12:15, right after the service, you can come in via Zoom, real time, and visit with all your favorite MABC friends. That link was in our e-blast. It's also on our website, and it's also on the YouTube site where you're perhaps watching now. So join us, everyone is welcome. I also want to give you a heads up that next Sunday is, yes, Christmas in July. Yay! We are going to celebrate not only the third sermon in my four sermon series, but we are going to celebrate Christmas. Why? Because we need to spread Christmas cheer throughout the year. And we will be talking about how we can spread love and Christmas cheer all year long. I want to start out with a word of gratitude today. A gratitude for our musicians, our music minister. I want to give some gratitude to our participants and our readers, and of course to our editor, Travis, who brings all of this together. I invite us now to start our service by sharing some of the joy that we will receive and have received from these services. Let us find someone that we love and reach out, passing the peace of Christ, please.
Good morning, Madison Avenue Baptist Church family. My name is Jamie Rodriguez, and I come to you this morning as a member of the Board of Community Ministries. I'd like to start off by thanking you for supporting our Pride initiative for the month of June with the Trevor Project, and also for the donations sent in for our summer initiative with the Uber Donate a Ride program. We'll be continuing to support this initiative through the rest of the summer. As a reminder, the Uber Donate a Ride program allows those who might not otherwise have transportation to their COVID-19 vaccine to be able to do so. So continue to send in your donations earmarked for that organization. In July, we are transitioning our monthly mission to a new group, the Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America, Bautistas por la Paz, or the BPFNA, as they're also known. Madison and the BPFNA have worked together for a number of years. The BPFNA's mission is really rooted in justice. They work with Baptist churches worldwide. They provide resources such as training programs, outreach missions, and peace camps. Their 2021 Summer Peace Camp actually kicks off at the end of this month on July 20th with what they're calling 40 Days with the BPFNA. This year's theme is Beyond Barriers, Soaring in the Spirit, and it's going to culminate in a virtual event on August 28th. We are looking to align our donations for this month to support this wonderful organization and really help them get to the finish line with their summer conference and support all of the work that they do. So we encourage you guys to go ahead and send your donations in to support the BPFNA. As always, you can send a check to the church or you can donate digitally via PushPay. This information will also be available for you in our weekly e-blast. We thank you for your continued support and remind you that the Community Ministries Board will match donations that are coming in from the congregation to help really boost up our opportunity to help these organizations. So we look forward to seeing those checks. Thank you so much for your continued support. Have a wonderful day.
Let the creator's praise arise. Hey everyone, my name is Mackenzie Warner and I'm coming to you from Port Chester, New York. Please hear our call to worship and join me in the boldface sections. Morning has broken. We gather to greet the new day by praising God. God created us for relationship with God, one another, and the earth. Let us honor those relationships today and every day. We seek to care for our brothers and sisters around the world and to God's good creation. Let us honor those relationships today and every day. May we commit to new ways of honoring your creation as a means of sharing Jesus' transforming love. And let us seek God's grace, justice, and mercy for all. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm back. And hey, it's Alex the Alto, but I'm not coming to you from the Bronx. I'm coming to you from Massachusetts. God of grace and God of glory. God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power, crown thine ancient church as story, bring its bar to glorious flower, grant us wisdom, grant us courage,
Good morning, Madison Avenue Baptist family. This is Karen, your mezzo in Manhattan once again. And the piece you are about to hear is a Leonard Bernstein composition. It's called A Simple Song, and it was originally written as part of a film score for Franco Zeffirelli, and then later incorporated into Bernstein's Mass, which was commissioned by Jackie Kennedy to celebrate the opening of the Kennedy Center. It's a beautiful piece. I hope you enjoy it.
Make it up as you go along. my days. Blessed is the one who loves the Lord. Blessed is the one who praises Him. Alleluia, 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 and walks in His way.
Welcome to our time of prayer. My name is Heather Ketchum. I am the assistant minister here at Madison, and I'm excited to be praying with you all this morning. We will begin by going through a prayer, which I wrote specifically for this morning in light of Susan's sermon, which I'm very excited about. And then after we walk through that, we'll have a brief moment of reflection. Then finally, we will close sing the Lord's Prayer together, and the words for that will be on the screen. So please join me now in a posture of prayer. God, you who made the heavens and the earth, who created mitochondria, protons, and DNA, who created the Rocky Mountains, the Grand Canyon, and the Great Lakes, here we are, praying to you in the midst of your creation. Our home. And see, our home is borrowed. And yet we have been destructive and negligent tenants. So bent on productivity, we wielded and roared machines without a care for our other, including the birds, trees, deer, and those whom we hold dear. The sweet incense that once arose in your tabernacle, we have replaced with the smokestacks and steam pipes which rise up and permeate decimation across the sky and seas, the continents and the islands. Forgive us for our worship of productivity. Teach us ways to worship that usher in life instead of extinguishing it. Teach us to care for the bees, not just a passing remark to appear woke, but to actually care for them. May the bees continue to buzz, stopping here and there, in this field and that, caring for us as they pollinate our food sources. Forgive us for our selfishness. And we might as well note, while we're here, here we are with our brand name and designer clothes, newly purchased clothes, cheap clothes and expensive clothes alike, with more outfits than we can wear in a month, and yet we still go out for more, filling our bags, satiating our appetites for new, fresh, and absolutely fabulous. All the while forgetting the millions in sweatshops, those enslaved and those greatly underpaid who produce these items we don for brunch. Forgive us for looking down on those who have shopped at consignment stores for years, and yet now praising those who go thrifting and find a hidden gem among the racks of tossed out cloth. May we care for our neighbor who is across the globe, working all day to make our perfect jogging outfit while making pennies. May we demand livable wages and not balk when the bill for those jeans is significantly higher. May we care for our neighbor who has no choice but to thrift. May we learn from them, not look down on them, but learn. God, make us equal. God, make life equitable. God, these are just a few of the things we note and ask forgiveness for. There's much more we could add to this list. Help us to actually live differently. Actually be good tenants of this home you have made for us. May we do some much needed renovations to repair the damage and decay we have eschewed responsibility for. May we care for this, our home. Now I invite you to spend a couple minutes reflecting on the ways that you have contributed yourself and also ways that you can change and help with these needed renovations of creation and of the earth. God, hear our prayers. May we take steps large and small today to care for your creation. Now we close our time of prayer, praying the Lord's Prayer together. Please join me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I am Jenny Lindsay, your resident soprano, coming at you from upper Manhattan. I hope you sing the next one with me. It's number 543. Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine! Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Good morning. My name's Han. I'm joining you from Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam. I will be reading our scripture for today, Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 to 45. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepare for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and give you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, naked, and you did not give me clothing, sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me."
The title of my sermon this morning is, "We'd Better Atlas Up." Now, just a little disclosure.
The announcements filmed in the heavy wool coat and the heavy wool hat in front of the fireplace were filmed yesterday when it was freezing cold, like mid-50s. Today, obviously, we've had a change of temperature. And I'm dressed in this Jimmy Buffett outfit out on the dock because it's going to hit somewhere near 90. But of course, there is no such thing as global warming. Climate change is a hoax, which is what we're going to be talking about today in my sermon. I'd like to welcome you to the second of a four-part sermon series entitled Plays Well With Fill in the Blanks. For those of you who watched last week, you know that last week's sermon was about plays well with others. And we talked about how we as human beings got basically an in for needs improvement on how we play well with others. Our scripture lesson taught us that if we hand over our human weaknesses, our anger, our resentment, our tendency to judge, our impatience, that God can refine those weaknesses into strengths and thus improve our score to a satisfactory. Now, this week we move to a different question. Our question today is, do we as human beings play well with the earth? I don't know if you could hear that. I've got to pause. There's an eagle, a bald eagle screaming in the background. How lovely for an environmental sermon. So now that there's a boat going by and drowning out the eagle, let me go back to my original question. Do we as human beings play well with the earth? I'm afraid the answer, like last week, is in. Is that, it's upside down, my bad. In needs improvement. In fact, we don't need to look any farther for evidence than the weather in the past couple of weeks. Now, you know all about the weather here in Wisconsin because you have seen my change of wardrobe. I also know that it's been crazy, crazy hot in New York City. But we've also seen headlines about places like Portland, Oregon and Palm Springs, California. But you know what? Forget the headlines. We have some local MABC experts who would like to weigh in about global warming. Let's start this morning with longtime MABC member and now associate pastor of First Baptist Portland, Oregon, Chris Shade and his son, Brian. Chris and Brian, what do you say to those who claim there is no global warming?
Brian, how hot was it a couple weeks ago?
It was so hot. You could cook an egg on the ground or your feet.
You could cook an egg on your feet?
Papa, you could cook an egg on the ground or your feet.
Cook your feet on the ground?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, y'all. Frying an egg, yeah, that's pretty hot. But all kidding aside, we raise up prayers for Portland. We know that there are many there who have lost property and, more tragically, lives in this heat wave. Now let's switch over to our own Joe Pila, co-chair of our Board of Hospitality, who just returned from a vacation in, yes, Palm Springs, California, where it was a chilly 118 degrees. Joe, what do you say to those who claim that there is no such thing as global warming?
Climate change is real. I just spent 5 days in Palm Springs and it was up to 118 degrees. And you can talk all you want about it's a dry heat, but the fact of the matter is, it's still 118 degrees. Climate change, it's real.
Well, amen to that, Joe. I mean, clearly it's been hot in the US, but guess what? We're not the only ones under a heat wave. Recently in India, for example, tens of millions of people in the northwest sector of the country, specifically in the New Delhi region, were affected by extreme heat, somewhere between 100 and 110 degrees consistently. In Iraq, authorities announced a public holiday in several provinces, including the capital of Baghdad, because it was simply too hot to work or study after temperatures surpassed 120 degrees and the electrical system collapsed. Hungary and Malta set new June records, both hitting 104 degrees. And last but not least, back at the ranch in Siberia, above the Arctic Circle, on June 20th, it reached a record-breaking 118 degrees. So I think we're all on board that climate change is real, that global warming is real. But I know what you're thinking. A lot of you are still sitting there thinking, well, so what? What's that got to do with me? I mean, I realize global warming happens, but why do I get the need to improve score? I didn't cause the global warming. You know, I didn't cause this horrible heat wave going on. It's not my fault. Well, let me ask you a question. When you got up this morning, what's the first thing you did? Perhaps, if you're like many of us, the first thing you did was turn on your phone. Now, come on, admit it. You know a lot of you, and I know I'm guilty of this too. The first thing we do is turn on our phone. Well, if you did, guess what? We all get a need to improve on how we treat the earth. Now, let me just pause for like 10 seconds for a quick environmental 101. You've probably all heard the term carbon footprint. That means the amount of greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide and methane, that are generated by our actions. Now, scientists call it a footprint because that's literally what it is. It is our indelible imprint, our impact on the earth through our actions. So back to our iPhones. The carbon footprint of our gadgets, the iPhones, the computers, the iPads, the internet and the systems supporting them is similar to the amount of greenhouse gases produced by the airline industry. Oh yes. Specifically, let's take email as an example. According to an article in the BBC recently, if every adult in the UK sent one less email a day, it would be equivalent to taking 3,334 diesel cars off the road. I mean, think about that. One less email. So the moral of the story here is stop with the multiple emails. Stop with the one emoji emails, you know? Say what you gotta say in as few words as possible. Well, how about streaming a video when you get up? I mean, some of us turn on the phone and maybe get an email or see something on the news feed and we start streaming a video. Maybe we should start thinking about limiting those as well. Here's a troubling example. A popular Justin Bieber video. For those who care, I'm talking about the remix of Despacito. It had over 5 billion streaming views, which was calculated to cause as much, or to generate as much electricity, to drain as much electricity as the countries of Chad, Guinea-Bissau, Somalia, Sierra Leone, and the Central African Republic in an entire year. Moral of the story, don't watch Justin Bieber videos, but bigger than that, let's limit our streaming. Now let's talk about the production of those gadgets. Apple's on track to, are you ready? To produce 250 million iPhones in 2021. The production of these iPhones is going to generate huge carbon levels, specifically because of the mining involved for the metals that are necessary for the phones. You know, there was a statistic that showed that one study said that to offset the carbon levels of the production of the iPhones in just 2021 would take 4,000 wind turbines running for the entire year. I mean, bottom line, at a minimum, limit your screen time. Stop with the 10,000 emails and don't buy a new iPhone every time one comes out. It's a win-win because limiting our screen time saves the earth and it saves our sanity. Everything we do impacts the earth. Our gadgets, our long hot showers. I mean, scientists are clear we're running out of water. Even our choice of food. Meat production, specifically the methane gas released through livestock production, is responsible for over 14% of all greenhouse gas emissions. But you know what? I think the issue was best described by Michael Pollan, who wrote the book, The Omnivore's Dilemma, when he said this. I'm laughing because I just love this quote. A vegan in a Hummer has a lighter carbon footprint than a beef eater in a Prius. The eagles are green. I don't know if you can hear them. A vegan in a Hummer has a lighter carbon footprint than a beef eater in a Prius. Can I have an amen? And the list goes on and on. Everything we do impacts the environment. We all have a carbon footprint. So in answer to our question, do we play well with the earth? The answer right now is no. Which is not only life-threatening for the human race, it is a clear breach of our ethical and spiritual duty as Christians. Now, there are so many scriptures that would apply here, but the one I love is our scripture read today, Jesus' words from the book of Matthew 25. Ones we know, say it with me. Truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me. Now, of course, there's also the flip side of that towards the end of the scripture. Truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for the least of these, you did not do for me. When you think about it, those words of Jesus from Matthew apply equally to all God's creation. I mean, how about this? For I was hungry and you did not give me something to eat. Said another way, we are starving the earth by polluting its seas and its air and its land. I was thirsty and you did not give me something to drink. Said another way, we are squandering the water supplies. I was sick and you looked after me. Friends, the earth is dying. And we have turned our backs. This is an existential crisis. We are way past thinking, oh, should I recycle or should I not? We're at the point that if we don't rethink every aspect of our life and how it impacts the earth, there won't be an earth for future generations. As the Archbishop of Cape Town said, we don't inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. I want to leave you today with an image. It's actually a combination of an image and a poem that to me is haunting and truly hammers home the crisis that we are facing. We begin with the familiar image of the statue of Atlas in front of Rockefeller Center in New York, carrying the earth and heavens on his shoulders. It's a fitting image for what is required of us today, because we are going to have to Atlas up. That's the title of my sermon today. We are going to have to Atlas up if we have any chance to save this holy creation. We are going to have to struggle. We're going to have to work. We're going to have to sacrifice. We're going to have to literally pick this earth up, this broken earth, and carry it on our shoulders if we have any chance for healing this land. But I want to add something to this image. It's a poem that I bet all of you know or have heard about, and it's a poem called Footprints, which is ironic since we're talking about carbon footprints. Now, I know this poem is in every Hallmark store in America, but it is so perfect, I think, for this issue. In the poem, the poet talks about walking along the beach with God and noticing that in the hardest parts of life, you know, the footprints in the sand were the trajectory of the poet's life. And in the hardest times of the poet's life, there were only one set of footprints. And the poet says to God, how could you leave me in these times? God's answer in the poem is exactly how we must answer the earth. My precious child, I love you. And will never leave you. Never, ever will I leave you during these trials and testing. For when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. And the people said,
Hello, my name is Tatiana. I'm a member of Madison Avenue Baptist Church, coming to you from San Diego, California. Please support this beautiful community of faith. There are a number of ways to give. You can write an old-fashioned check and mail it to the church. The address of the church is on the website at mabcnyc.org. You can also find other options to give online, or you can download the app and give there just by swiping. Or if that's not easy enough, you can text MABCNYC to 77977 and follow the prompts. Thank you so much for your support, especially during this time of crisis. And while you write the check or swipe on your phone, please enjoy our beautiful offertory music.
My strength, my song.
This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh,
fullness of God in helpless babe,
this gift of love and righteousness,
scorned by the ones he came to save.
Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry,
from life to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no human plan, can ever pluck me from his hand.
Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
All other ground is sinking sand. Till he returns,
till he calls me home,
here in the power of
stand.
Good morning, Madison Avenue Baptist Church. This is Richard Binder, your MABC choir tenor, inviting you to join me at what I'm sure is one of your favorites, hymn number 546, Amazing Grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun.
Well, welcome to weather pattern number 3. It's cold again, and the lake is fogged in. I'm so glad that you joined us for this weather tour of Wisconsin service today. Please remember that no matter where you're coming in from, no matter where we're coming in from, this is a community of faith in which you are always welcome, and you will always be considered family. And until we see you again, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and bring you peace. Amen.